I am Cody Walker from the Department of English, and welcome to the middle years. And before I begin, let me just say, I think most people have figured this out, but we have a kind of a party favor of sorts. Frostbite and Frostbark, Robert Frost at Michigan. Something that the Bentley Library put out back in the late 90s, I believe, and we obtained several hundred of them. So there are still more at the table behind you, and if you haven't picked one up yet, feel free to do so. Okay, thanks. So again, the middle years. I may be the right person to introduce this panel, if only because I am in my middle years, or perhaps even my middle year. On birthdays, Tom Lynch always tells his friends to go for the 100. And, well, I turned 50 a couple of months ago, so right in the middle. The way we're defining the middle years here, though, is somewhat less precise. It's a rather thick middle, beginning with Theodore Rutke, who did undergraduate and then graduate work at U of M in the late 1920s and early 1930s, just a handful of years after Frost's final stint as a poet in residence. The early 1940s brought us Robert Hayden, who was pursuing a master's degree, and W.H. Auden, who was teaching a famously impossible to get through syllabus and smoking a lot of cigarettes. Frank O'Hara was here in the early 1950s, and Marge Piercy just after that. Donald Hall joined the English department faculty in 1957 and stayed 18 years, leaving in 1975 with an Ann Arbor native and a great poet, Jane Kenyon. X.J. Kennedy worked on a PhD here in the late 1950s and early 1960s, winning two Hopwood Awards along the way. And I want to pause right there, because X.J. Kennedy, or Joe Kennedy, to his friends, is, I think, one of the great living American poets, and also one of the great comic spirits of our time. He's 88 and still enormously energetic. He published a very funny novel a few years ago. He published a new collection of poetry only a month ago. And he enthusiastically agreed to be on this panel when we invited him several months ago. Unfortunately, his wife Dorothy, who was also a grad student at Michigan, the two met in an Austin Warren seminar and were married in Ann Arbor, has taken ill, and Joe needs to be by her side. So I'd like to suggest that we raise a glass to Joe and to Dorothy and to wish them the best wishes that can be wished. So to Joe and Dorothy, and may they continue to thrive. Back briefly to the narrative. In 1969, Robert Hayden returned to U of M, this time as a professor, and stayed until his death in 1980. Nobel laureates Czeslaw Milosz and Joseph Brodsky taught here off and on in the 1970s and 80s. MacArthur Award winner Alice Fulton taught here in the 1980s and 90s. So, that takes us up to the turn of the century and to the end of our thick middle. For a more comprehensive tour of Poets of Michigan, you can go to the Hatcher Grad Library in the lobby space just off the Diag and see an exhibit that tells a story from Frost to the present. You can see Frost's letters, Rutke's doodles, and O'Hara's Hopwood poems. It runs until the end of the month. And let me add that that exhibit would in no way exist without the tireless efforts of Sigrid Cordell. So thank you so much, Sigrid, for all of your work on that exhibit. And now it's my great pleasure to introduce our panelists. Laurence Goldstein is professor of English at the University of Michigan and former editor of the university's flagship scholarly and creative writing journal, Michigan Quarterly Review. He's the author of four volumes of poetry, including the breathtakingly brilliant A Room in California, and the author, editor, or co-editor of many, many, many scholarly works, most recently Writing Ann Arbor, a literary anthology. His most recent work of literary criticism is Poetry Los Angeles, Reading the Essential Poems of the City. Larry is also one of the co-organizers of this symposium, and he's in many ways the institutional memory of this place. The person I go to when I have a question along the lines of, what was Robert Hayden like? Larry is wise and funny and generous, and he's also retiring in about 2 weeks. It's hard for me to imagine the English department without Larry, and I hope that I won't have to. Maybe you'll come visit us twice a week, three times a week. Anyway, when we don't see you, we'll assume that you're writing, and we'll look forward to the books to come. John Knott joined the English department of U of M in 1967. He published three scholarly works on Renaissance literature in the 1970s and 1980s. In the 1990s, his teaching and research interests gradually shifted to literature and the environment. He published a critical book that grew out of a course he developed in the literature of the American wilderness, Imagining Wild America, and has edited or co-edited several collections dealing with the environment, including The Huron River, Voices from the Watershed, and Michigan, Our Land, Our Water, Our Heritage. John was chair of the Department of English from 1982 to 87, during which time he started the MFA program in creative writing. He also helped establish the Institute for the Humanities and the program in the environment and served as director of each before retiring in 2006. When we found ourselves one panelist short a mere 2 weeks ago, the committee immediately thought of John, and he quickly agreed to join us. Thank you, John, for that kindness and for your 50 years of service to this community. Thomas Lynch is the author of five collections of poems, four books of essays, and a collection of stories. And I may not even have the math right. Tom has written a lot of books. His work has been the subject of two film documentaries, the first of which won an Emmy, and the second of which won the Michigan Prize, awarded by Michael Moore. He's taught with the Department of Mortuary Science at Wayne State University, with the graduate program in writing at the University of Michigan, and with the Candler School of Theology at Emory University. He's a charter member of the faculty of the Bear River Writers Conference, where he's a much beloved workshop leader in basically any genre, poetry, fiction, memoir, you name it. He lives in Milford, Michigan, where he's been the funeral director since 1974, and in Louvain, County Clare, Ireland, where he keeps an ancestral cottage. That's a bio line I'm always a bit jealous of. It makes Tom sound like a figure from a fairy tale. And there is something both larger than life and impish about Tom. You want to be around him to see where his imagination leads, and you want to be around him to hear his laughter. My students have been reading from his collection, Still Life in Milford, these past couple of weeks, so they've already experienced how he masterfully balances gravity and levity. Now you'll get to as well. I give you Larry Goldstein, John Knott, and Tom Lynch.
Thank you. As Cody just said, this second panel is charged with speaking about poets who, as students or faculty, spent time at the University of Michigan from the date of Robert Frost's residence in the early 1920s through about 1990. This is an impossible task, but we will try to stimulate your interest in the range of wonderful poets who have settled here for a short or long period. I'd like to begin by reading a poem about Ann Arbor, written by a University of Michigan undergraduate in the early 1950s. Ann Stevenson, who is now one of Great Britain's most honored poets. Her collected poems have come out from Oxford University Press. The poem, titled Ann Arbor, appears in a volume titled Living in America. published by Generation Press, thanks to funding by the Board of Student Publications, funded by the University of Michigan. See if you can spot any differences between the Ann Arbor of the 1950s and the present day. Neither city nor town, even its location, is ambiguous. Of north and east and middle west, it both is and is not. In every case, a hopeless candidate for the picturesque. Trees and a few grand old accidentally preserved houses save it from total suburbanization, give it the mildly authentic complexion of secondhand furniture. No setting for tragedy, it is the scene, nonetheless, for more than its surfeit of traffic would suggest. Entrances and exits are frequent enough to be anonymous. Every year, the young adolesce in its residences. The usual academic antipathies enliven the cocktail parties, while, driven from their garrets, dim graduate students gripe in their beer joints, leaving their wives to cope with babies and contemporary interior decoration. In all the tongues of the world, its tone is Germanic and provincial. Yugoslav, Hindus, Japanese fraternize in the supermarkets where bean sprouts and Braunschweiger are equally available. Love is frequently experienced over jugs of California claret. Politics are important and culture so cheap and convenient that any evening you could expect thin strains of Mozart to issue from half a dozen windows. The women who do not run for aldermen paint pictures, write poetry, or give expensive parties for the members of visiting symphony orchestras. Their children are well-fed, rude, and intelligent, while alone in immense mysterious houses live the witches who remember the coaches of the first city fathers. A microcosm, something of a mosaic, always paradoxical. With scenery, it has little to do. And if you venerate antiquity or feel wiser where there is history, you will, of course, prefer Cambridge. Though even there, the proportion of good people to bad architecture is probably about the same. Back to 1923. As we heard this morning, Robert Frost's residence at the University of Michigan is a perfect example of the mutually beneficial cooperation of academia and the literary world. President Marion Burton wanted to enhance the art community on campus. To do so, he turned to one of the most celebrated authors in the country. The previous panel has reminded us how complex and fruitful the negotiation can become between writer and administrator, and how rewarding the outcome could be, resonating down to our heartfelt tributes of gratitude today. Robert Frost was the perfect choice, the right person at the right time. If we think of the literary situation a generation earlier, we have to ask whether poetic geniuses like Walt Whitman, Emily Dickinson, Evan Arlington Robinson, and James Weldon Johnson would have fit so smoothly into the classrooms of the university in the early 1920s. They would certainly have shaken up the English department and the students, and that might have been a very good thing. But as an inspiring oracle and a wily rule breaker, Frost was an excellent choice begin the tradition of seeking and signing up an eminent writer to meet with students and guide them through their first literary efforts. What we learn also is how it takes a strong-minded university president and college deans to enact that kind of radical change in teaching protocols. I would cite the kindred example of nearby Olivet College as well. In the late 1930s, President Joseph Brewer decided he wanted to make the college more arts-friendly. He established a summer writers' conference, And when Fort Maddox Ford showed up, he buttonholed this British man of letters and offered him a job. Ford, the author or co-author of 32 novels and many books of literary history, was a great novelist. The word great has become problematic in our time, but I cling to the definition I first heard from a professor of mine at UCLA. Quote, a great poet is someone who has written at least one great poem. I will specify Ford's The Great Soldier as a great novel. Robert Frost imagined his students, inspired his students by compelling them to study and recite great poems of the past. Fort Maddox Ford undoubtedly told many anecdotes about the great authors he had personally tutored and helped to become eminent. Joseph Conrad, D.H. Lawrence, Virginia Woolf, Henry James, and Ezra Pound among them. Those were fortunate students. We know that in the 1920s, and especially the hungry decade of the 1930s, the poetic tradition was honored in the academy. But living poets, some of them very hungry indeed, were kept at arm's length. Faculty committees often resisted the notion of hiring poets. There was a palpable fear of having the center of literary study bend too far to the modern and contemporary. Students might prefer it in numbers too large for comfort to enroll in poetry writing courses rather than poetry study courses. The visiting poet, always a he rather than a she, seemed to be an acceptable compromise for both the institution and the poet. The school would see its reputation enhanced, and the poet could finance his next couple of years in creative solitude as he began or finished a new poem, or new poems. In the 20 years that followed Frost's presence in the English department, only two poets of his stature graced the university. Theodore Rettke, born and raised in Saginaw, received a BA here in 1929 and an MA in 1936. Rettke was an unruly, in some ways an unstable student, but clearly from his first year at U of M, a genius. When I arrived here in 1970, Rettke's freshman composition teacher, Carlton Wells, was still in the faculty. I asked him about Rettke, and he said his clearest memory of him was that in a course that required weekly compositions, Rettke never turned in any work until the last day of the semester, when he dumped some 16 short essays on Wells' desk and exited hurriedly from the classroom. Rettke hoped to join the faculty here, but a nervous breakdown in the 1930s, followed by a spell at Merseywood, a local hospital, discouraged the university, alas, from placing him on the faculty. We'll hear more about Rettke before this panel is finished. Also in the 1930s, we find universities confronting the Great Depression, as well as the oncoming war in the European and Pacific theaters. Some exiles from Europe found their way to shelter in America, such as the Frankfurt School of Critical Critique, Cultural Critique. That would be, among others, Theodor Adorno, Max Horkheimer, and Herbert Marcuse, as well as composers like Arnold Schoenberg and Igor Stravinsky, filmmakers like Fritz Lang and Jean Renoir, playwrights like Bertolt Brecht, and authors like Christopher Isherwood and W.H. Auden. These immigrants contributed significantly to the modernist design of American culture, and we are still profoundly in their debt. W.H. Auden taught summer school course at the aforementioned Olivet College in 1941, and then began teaching at the University of Michigan. In 1940, Auden's volume, Another Time, had conclusively demonstrated that this 33-year-old prodigy was a major poet. Almost every poem of his we study in anthologies is a work of the 1930s. Like Frost, he only spent 2 years at Michigan, but his exalted reputation drew our English department into its glorious spotlight and put us on the map of great institutions welcoming to poets and poetry. 30 years after he left Ann Arbor, Auden worked with the U of M administration to bring Joseph Brodsky to the Slavic Languages Department in 1987. In 1987, when Brodsky was no longer in residence here, alas, he was awarded the Nobel Prize for Literature, and in 1991, he was appointed Poet Laureate of the United States. As it happens, Auden refused to teach either creative writing or modern poetry, though he was ever watchful and nurturing for young poets who showed the same spark of early talent he possessed in his undergraduate years. One of the student poets who most impressed Auden was Robert Hayden, about whom I would like to speak at more length. Like Repke, Hayden was Michigan-born and bred. He grew up in Detroit, an industrial powerhouse associated, of course, with the automobile, the single greatest symbol of American leadership in manufacturing. I'm sure I'm not the only person to see a dynamic connection between Detroit and Ann Arbor, seemingly so unlike, as Ann Stevenson suggested, but linked by their shared respect for intellect and advanced techniques. Robert Hayden's early verse, so far uncollected, focused on the figures of workers in the automobile factories, just as Diego Rivera did when painting his magnificent murals at the Detroit Institute of Arts, the iconic heart of Detroit culture. Like Auden and Frost, Hayden addressed matters of historical concern, specifically African-American experience. Hayden's Hopwood Award-winning manuscript, The Black Sphere, has poems of sweetness and light, but also poems about black history in America full of anger and resentment. He wrote so-called proletarian poetry about life during the Depression, and especially the hard life of dwellers in the Detroit ghetto where he grew up. Auden could see that this was a poet on his way to greatness, and the two authors kept in touch for the rest of their lives. Hayden received a bachelor's degree from Detroit City College, now known as Wayne State University, in 1942, and a master's degree from the University of Michigan in 1944. When in the mid-1940s and shortly afterward he began writing masterful poems like Frederick Douglass, Those Winter Sundays, The Ballad of Nat Turner, and Middle Passage, he dared to hope that he might be taken on as assistant professor in the university that knew him so well. But that was not to be, and he took a job at Fisk University in Nashville in 1946. Overworked, he nevertheless wrote one superior poem after another. We can credit Russell Fraser, newly appointed as chair of the English department in Michigan, for journeying to Fisk in 1969 and offering Hayden a position here as a full professor. Hayden was not the first poet of color to teach in the department. That would be Lemuel Johnson, an immigre from Sierra Leone, who was hired in 1967. Johnson's three volumes of poetry, which he named the Sierra Leone Trilogy, focused on West African history. Using an experimental style, he opened up historical materials of which almost every American remains ignorant. Few modern poets have seen more deeply than Robert Hayden into the historical depravity of human beings. But amazingly, few poets have been a more persuasive ambassador for the uplifting vision of humanity so essential to our lives. In her study of biblical literature titled For the Love of God, Alicia Ostriker writes these words: "How to praise is one great lesson of the Psalms. Literature in English is irrigated by these poems, not only because of the multitude of memorable phrases in the King James Version, but also because they are always telling us to celebrate, praise, open ourselves to the universe. That is the task of the poet, or at least I take it to be my task as a poet and human being, attempting to open myself in praise of an existence that inevitably includes suffering, anguish, pain, despair." The hiring of poets to teach our students, the institutional support for activities like the Hopwood program and the Hopwood room, the encouragement of all student writing at the undergraduate and graduate level, not just poetry, that nourishes the public imagination, the subventions for the University of Michigan Press with its enormously influential series, Poets on Poetry, and also Under Discussion, as well as scholarly treatments of poems and poetics. These are essential services of the House of Intellect. I have to add that I saw this morning in the list of Guggenheim Fellowship winners, Victoria Chang, who was in a creative writing class I taught, and has now just published her fourth book. Go, Victoria. Language amplifies our sense of the real, as many poets and scholars have labored to explain. The support given by educational institutions to this super pleasurable and civilizing activity is an empowering of what is positive and hope-inducing in our literate society. I'm sorry to repeat myself, but this truth cannot be too often repeated, especially in these dark times. Robert Hayden succeeds in speaking of the beauty of the human and natural world. Like Frost, Redke, and Auden, and like the Afro-Jamaican poet Lorna Goodison and African-American Thylas Moss, who joined the Michigan faculty in the later decades of the 20th century, he believed with all his heart in the public benefit of a poetry that enhanced the quality of life for its readers. It is appropriate that Hayden was named as the Poet Laureate of the United States by his fellow Michigander, President Gerald Ford, the present Poet Laureate Juan Felipe Herrera has pledged to carry forward Hayden's humanistic vision. Always in speaking of one poet, we pay tribute to other poets who carry on the same inspirational work. I want to close by speaking briefly of two poets who performed this redemptive task for students and a vast audience of readers, Donald Hall and Jane Kenyon. Donald Hall taught for some 20 years in the Department of English at this university from 1957 to 1977, the longest period of any major poet. That is how I see him, as major, as eminent and canonical, a superb technician, and through his books of poetry and poetry criticism, immensely influential on poets from the 1950s to the present. He too has served as a Poet Laureate of the United States. Like Redke, Hall, and also his student, and later his wife, Jane Kenyon, wrote with that inspired voice of praise that Alicia Ostriker refers to as psalm-like, joyful in the abundance of flowers and birds and fields and forests and the changing seasons. And he is brutally honest in his appraisal of the social condition in the postmodern period. Both poets traveled the country bringing their poems to appreciative audiences. Not long after their marriage, they moved to New Hampshire, but retained contact with friends and fellow poets in Ann Arbor. Jane Kenyon's evocation of the New Hampshire rural landscape, the land of heart's desire, have had a profound effect on young poets in America and abroad. The love poems of this exquisitely matched couple are just what the biblical Psalms mandated, not to mention the Song of Songs. And Don's grief-stricken poems after Jane's death respond to and extend Theodore Redke's famous elegy for his student, Jane, followed thrown by a horse. How much we have all learned about joy and sorrow who have taken the poems of these University of Michigan authors to heart. Last paragraph. Many poets have passed through the hallways and offices of this campus. I think of my predecessor as editor of the Michigan Quarterly Review, Radcliffe Squires, whose selected poems will be published by Wake Forest University Press this year, and Nancy Willard, Radcliffe's favorite student, a Newbery Award winner who delighted so many, probably millions, of readers with her books of poetry for children and teenagers, and her many volumes directed adults. Another personal favorite of mine is Lawrence Joseph, also a native of Detroit, who has been a faithful friend of the University of Michigan since his graduation with a law degree back in the early 1970s. You don't have to be an English major to write distinguished poetry. You will find a list of poets from the University of Michigan in your program, a partial list to which many names will be added in the near future and made available on a website. The University of Michigan continues to provide temporary home for those writers, and they repay their hosts by making this a genuine art city, a utopian site of envy and gratitude for readers around the world. Let the parade continue.
Time with Brodsky and Hayden, where you first wrote about them, with a couple of short poems that highlight the teach. The poems both deal with a difficult relationship with a father, and they're among their most popular poems. One test of the durability of poems is how well they work in the classroom, and by that measure, these have lasted very well. In Brodsky's My Papa's Waltz, the speaker recreates a childhood scene from the perspective of an adult. To understand what the boy in the poem is feeling, we have to determine its tone. To do that, we have to look closely at the language and at what is actually happening in the poem. I'll read it for you. The whiskey on your breath could make a small boy dizzy, but I hung on like death. Such waltzing was not easy. We romped until the pan slid from the kitchen shelf. My mother's countenance not unfrowned itself. The hand that held my wrist was battered on one knuckle. At every step you missed, my right ear scraped a buckle. You beat time on my head with a palm caked hard by dirt, then waltzed me off to bed, still clinging to your shirt. We know that the father's been drinking, but his waltz with his young son becomes a romp that knocks pans off the shelf and dismays his mother. The son hangs on like death, and that the scene ends with the father putting the son to bed. Most people would say that the father is reckless and either doesn't notice or doesn't care that he alarms his wife and frightens his son. The scene is charged with tension and could explode, yet it doesn't quite. The bouncy rhythm of the poem holds it together. The father isn't on a rampage, he's waltzing, drunk. When he puts his son to bed, he still waltzes. As if in a barely controlled way. Could we justify this waltz as a means of expressing his affection for his son, a kind of rough play? The son has a hard time keeping up and scrapes his ear on his father's buckle every time his father misses a step. He's clinging to his father's shirt the whole time. Is he terrified or excited or maybe both? And why does the speaker, presumably the boy looking back as an adult, mention the father's battered knuckle and his palm caked hard by dirt? The details establish the fact that he worked with his hands. Rathke's father ran a greenhouse in Saginaw, and could be a way of registering sympathy for him on the part of the adult speaker, at least. How you read the poem is likely to depend on how you understand its tone, and critics disagree about this. I used to make the poem the basis of a written exercise on tone, and then in discussing it, try to get students to recognize the complexity of feelings and relationships involved. Robert Hayden's Those Winter Sundays also renders the tensions of the relationship between a young son and a father, but without the edginess and ambiguities of Rathke's poem. Hayden's poem focuses on the transformation of the speaker's attitude and his desire to make up for his earlier coolness toward his father. Hayden grew up in a poor neighborhood in Detroit with foster parents in a household that had its tensions. This is Those Winter Sundays. Sundays too, my father got up early and put his clothes on in the blue-black coat. Then with cracked hands that ached from labor in the weekday weather made banked fires blaze. No one ever thanked him. I'd wake and hear the cold splintering, breaking. When the rooms were warm, he had called, and slowly I would rise and dress fearing the chronic angers of that house, speaking indifferently to him, who had driven out the cold and polished my good shoes as well. What did I know of love's austere and lonely offices? What I hope students would see is how economically and effectively Hayden uses language to suggest the cold, blue-black, and sputtering like ice as the house warms up. The father's hard labor, the cracked and aching hands, the chronic angers of the house that the boy fears and gets up slowly to avoid as long as he can, and the sense of guilt and of the need to make amends that emerges in the last stanza with the speaker's indictment of his indifference and his recognition of the love he couldn't see earlier. The last two lines, with their sudden directness, dramatically ratchet up the emotional intensity of the poem. What did I know? What did I know of love's austere and lonely offices? When Lee Bollinger was president of the university, I sent him a copy of those winter sonnets, thinking that he would like it and that he should be aware of Robert Hayden, who died in 1980. I had known Lee for years, and my wife was working for him in the president's office at the time. I was surprised when he incorporated the poem into his spring commencement address, though perhaps I shouldn't have been, given the fact that he had liberally quoted from a poem by Robert Frost, Spring Pools, in his formal acceptance of the presidency at a Regents meeting. By the time Bob Hayden returned to teach at Michigan in 1969, and as you've heard, he'd been recognized as one of the country's leading African-American poets, though he didn't like to be thought of as a black poet, but as an American one, writing in the tradition of English and American literature. He was criticized by some for not being militant, but that was not his temperament. I knew him when he was a member of the faculty as a sensitive, highly cultured man, suffering from severe nearsightedness as he had his whole life. His death in 1980 at 66 was a great shock to those who knew him. I learned of it on a weekend, and when I taught a class the following Monday in which we were to discuss some difficult modernist poetry, I began by telling the students about Robert Hayden and then reading those winter Sundays as a kind of memorial tribute. The effect of reading the poem in those circumstances on me, and I believe on the students, was so strong that I suddenly realized it would be wrong to switch abruptly to the ordinary business of the class, so I let the students go. The only time I've ever done that. I was guilty of being irresponsible that day, but I think the students may have learned something about the power of poetry. I hope so. Lee Bollinger's presidency, which was 1996 to 2002, was a time when the arts received extraordinary support from the highest levels of the administration. He found the considerable funds necessary to bring the Royal Shakespeare Company to Ann Arbor for the first of what turned into several residencies, and made it possible for the English department to bring a number of high-profile writers to campus for readings, including Derek Walcott and Seamus Heaney, both after they had won the Nobel Prize, presumably gotten much more expensive. Lee wanted to bring the house in which Frost had lived in Ann Arbor, Pontiac Trail House, back from Greenfield Village, and install it in a prominent central campus location, make it a center for literary arts, including poetry, that would reinforce the university's association with Frost. That didn't happen, but the vision was consistent with the university's tradition of fostering creative writing. Lee's active patronage of the arts was unusual, but not unique. Harold Shapiro, who preceded him, raised the money that made it possible to launch the Humanities Institute and spoke at its inaugural event. A reading by Arthur Miller from his autobiography, Time Bends, after hosting a dinner for Miller and his wife, Inga McGrath, at the president's house before the reading. He was a great fan of Miller's play, a genuine fan. Other administrators responded to opportunities presented by the faculty, and one that I remember that Larry has mentioned is bringing in Joseph Brodsky, or at least making it possible for him to teach here. He came really, as some other dissidents did, because of Karl Proffer's presence here in the Slavic department, and the fact that he and his wife ran a publishing house, Artists, that was a mecca for dissidents in those days. Brodsky left for a year to do visiting stints and came back here for six more. One thing I've noticed from my flirtations with administration here is that a thing writers have going for them, including poets, is a glamour administrators at the college or the university level don't typically associate with demographers, physicists, and other academic types they deal with all the time. Good writers can command attention outside the academic community, as well as in life of the community itself. And in Michigan, at least, the people who control the funds have often responded to the ability of poets to appeal to a broader audience, broader public. Today's lively writing at the scene at the university is very lively, with its large contingent of writers on regular or visiting faculty appointments, 10 on the current roster of the Zell Writers Program, and its procession of writers coming through to give readings and remain several days for residencies, may seem normal to our students, but if they had arrived in 1967, as I did, they would have found a very different scene. Alan Seeger, the only bona fide fiction writer in the English department at the time, had just retired. We were better represented in poetry with Radcliffe Squires and Donald Hall, and by 1969, Robert Hayden as well, and Lynn Johnson, a much younger poet and critic who came as an assistant professor in 1967. They were all estimable poets, but not so much a community of writers as a collection of individuals with distinctive spheres of influence. Don Hall would leave in 1975 with Jane Kenyon to see if he could make it as a freelance writer living on his grandparents' New Hampshire farm. And it's interesting that a popular how to write book, writing well, was what enabled him to make the leap. He made enough money on it. It's now in its 9th edition, presumably still making money for him, I hope so. Leaving the university to our loss was the right thing for Don Hall to do, right now. He was versatile in prose as well as poetry, and he could make it as a freelancer. He was right for Jane Kenyon as well. Her poetry flourished, drawing on her daily life at Eagle Pond Farm and on the cycles of the seasons she observed so acutely. She also traced the seasons of melancholy and left a body of work before her early death from leukemia in 47 that has drawn a large readership. One unforgettable poem, maybe a great poem of hers, ends, "Let the fox go back to its sandy den, let the wind die down, let the shed go black inside, let evening come. To the bottle in the ditch, to the stoop in the oats, to air in the lung, let evening come. Let it come as it will, and don't be afraid. God does not leave us comfortless, so let evening come." In his time at Michigan, Don Hall was a charismatic teacher who could draw 100 non-English majors to a lecture course designed to introduce them to poetry. He brought attention to the university through his reputation and his extensive friendships with prominent poets, really all the prominent poets of his time. Many of these came to Ann Arbor to give readings at a time, the 60s and early 70s, when poetry readings were still a relatively new phenomenon on college campuses. Visitors in those days included all friends of Don's, included Robert Bly, Galway Cannell, James Wright, Andrew Rich, Philip Levine, Gary Snyder, among others. For a while, Bert Hornback, a former colleague, ran a series of weekly readings with minimal funding. And later, in the early 1980s, he organized a spectacular evening of poetry in Rackham Auditorium with an all-star lineup. Maybe some of you were there. He charged $5.50 a ticket to cover the cost of renting the auditorium and getting the poets here, all friends who welcomed the chance to spend time with each other. The program, the long run, consisted of serial readings by Don Hall, Galway Cannell, Wendell Berry, and Shane Seedy. It was a lollapalooza of a poetry reading to a full house, plus a standing room, ticket standing room. The auditorium holds 1,100, with scalpers selling tickets on the steps of Rackham. report we're reading. That's a great event in Northern history, I think. Don Hall has written about it in his memoir, Unpacking the Boxes. There was a sequel with Sharon Olds and some of the same participants, the original participants. Despite this burst of activity, there was relatively little funding for bringing writers to campus, apart from that of the Hopwood program for the annual reading in the winter and the lecture in the spring, both associated with award ceremonies. The existence of the Hopwood program was crucial to the English department's decision to launch an MFA program in creative writing in the early 1980s, a program that would metamorphose into today's Zell Writers Program. That and the support of faculty who thought we should expand our commitment to creative writing in this way, and were willing to do the work necessary to define the UMFA program. Most prominently, Larry Goldstein and Jack Aldrich, who was then directing the Hopwood program. The tradition of support for creative writing in Michigan that the program represents strengthened our rationale for entering what had become a crowded and highly competitive world of MFA programs by then. And it made it easier to win the necessary approvals to offer a new degree. We knew that we would have to cobble together funding necessary to attract students and assume, rightly as it turned out, that they would win their share and more of the graduate Hopwood awards. I was chairing the English department at the time and organized two receptions for best Hopwood winners, one in New York and one in Ann Arbor, to renew their connection to the university at a time when we were placing greater emphasis on creative writing, and also to jumpstart fundraising for bringing in visiting writers. Arthur Miller spoke at the New York reception, along with fiction writer Max Apple and screenwriter David Newman. They represented three generations. And Miller testified to the importance of his undergraduate experience in Michigan. He was always willing to do that. He subsequently made a generous gift to help us finance visitors, and other gifts came out of that time. A number of out-of-towners came to the Ann Arbor event, one of whom was John Chardy. In his prime, known as a poet and translator, the editor of the Saturday Review, and a TV and radio personality. And for a number of years, I'm told, after World War II, he was simply the most popular poet in the country, the best known. Like Miller and others, he was drawn to Michigan by the reputation of the Hopwood Awards. Chardy told me that he had borrowed money from his Uncle Max for his tuition. And when Uncle Max asked how you were paying back, Chardy said he was going to win a Hopwood Award, and he did. Our young MFA program became the English department's primary vehicle for bringing in visiting writers with whatever funding we could put together. When Nick Del Banco came to Michigan, take over the directorship of the program, succeeding the original director, George Garrett, he steadily raised its profile, making it one of the best in the country. Among other things, Nick created new opportunities for students to interact with visiting writers by instituting residencies of almost a week for selected visitors. They would give a reading and perhaps another presentation, participate in classes, and meet individually with students. Among the leading writers who came through these residencies were fiction writers Michael Ondaatje and Russell Banks, nonfiction writer Barry Lopez, and the one I remember best, Seamus Heaney, who allowed himself to be worked so hard that at one point I encouraged him to slow down and say no occasionally. He was patient and generous with students, and he gave a remarkable reading one evening in the Rackham Amphitheater. The reading had been well publicized and drew Irish admirers of his poetry from all over Southeast Michigan. The place was packed with people standing 10 deep in the doorways, but Heaney made it feel intimate, as if we were listening to him read poems and tell a few stories in the pub. With rising demand for creative writing courses, including workshops for MFA students, as well as an increasingly popular sequence of courses for undergraduates who wanted to pursue creative writing, we were able to justify hiring more faculty writers. By then, there was no argument from the faculty about the value of having writers among us, teaching literature as well as writing courses. And we had learned that MFA students brought fresh perspectives to our literature courses. Writing faculty who joined us in the 1980s and early 1990s included poets Richard Tillinghast, Alice Fulton, Nylius Moss, and Joe Rosser. we hired Linda Gregerson as a scholar of English Renaissance literature who happened to write some poetry and saw her increasingly focus her energies on her poetry and win awards for it while gaining recognition for her scholarly writing as well. Since that time, we've had a procession of poets on the faculty, including Ann Carson, Van Jordan, and Caribbean poet Lorna Goodison. Some have left, others have retired, others have been hired away. Others that have been brought here, hired here more recently, including Halit Matawa and Laura Kosicki, well known for her fiction as well as her poetry. You don't make appointments of the sort we have in creative writing without strong support from the institution, most immediately from the dean of the college, who sometimes plays a critical role in negotiations. The dean and the elected faculty executive committee must approve all faculty appointments, and they respond to quality, mainly as this is measured by external recognition. When your MFA graduates publish a flood of books, many of them prize winners as your faculty win praise and accumulate national honors, those of the university that you depend on for support pay attention. Success begets success. It helps, of course, to have donors like Helen Zell and her husband, who by handsomely endowing the MFA program have made it likely that Michigan will continue to compete for the best writing students in the country and to maintain its outstanding writing faculty. I just want to say to conclude that internal recognition is another measure of the respect in which creative writing is held at Michigan. And we've had several important signals of this in recent years. Laura Kosicki now holds a collegiate professorship in LSA at the Presidential College. And Nick Delbanco and Linda Gregerson were both named university professors, a distinction reserved for a select group of faculty across the university. Linda Gregerson's recent selection as the Henry Russell Lecturer, the highest honor a faculty member can receive from the university, established a new high watermark for poets at Michigan. I should say poet scholars, for Linda is both. Listening to her subtle and illuminating analysis of Milton's famous sonnet on his blindness in her Russell Lecture, after hearing her praised by Dresden Schlissel, I would have to say that poetry and poets are commanding their share of attention in the university. That should please us all. We've come a long way since 1967, and the future is full of promise. Thank you.
Pleasure, and when I first got word of this event and my invitation to it, I was very grateful that it was taking place in National Poetry Month, because it gives me an opportunity to remind us that one of the things that we should do in National Poetry Month is buy poetry at retail, and that man in the back from Literati Booksellers has proof positive that poetry is being committed in Ann Arbor and its environs by people who you may be sitting with, and if you buy a book of poetry, you can regift it to that brother-in-law who seems to have everything. He doesn't have any of those, I promise you. You can get him one of those. Or two. They probably have a deal going where if you buy three, you get what? 20% off or something like it. It being poetry. Last night I was invited by, I was invited about a month ago by my nephew, a boy schooled by the Jesuits with theological leanings and literary instincts, to come to a Russian bathhouse on the east side of Woodward, Detroit. It has a history associated with the Purple Gang and some other unsavory people, but he's accustomed to rescuing fallen properties. He has a one of the old Kresge mansions in Arden Park, where we've launched Keith Taylor's most recent book down there in February. And so I, even though I was then later invited to attend the launch of George Bornstein's new book, The Wild Swans at Poole, a facsimile edition of Yeats's 1919 publication, which observes all the protocols that Yeats's sister, I believe, first published it at Letterpress, tried to observe. Now, Nick Del Banco's remarks about Avery Hopwood arriving without his coffin or his clothes put me in mind of this night at the Russian bathhouse where I had achieved states of nakedness and perspiration that I'm unaccustomed to, and I'm not accustomed to being that intimate with others of my species in similar undress. But I want to say to you, Nick, as someone who has suffered, as I have, the stabbings of medicos and, you know, the insertion of foreign devices, it's not bad for you. You can take it. So go down there once in a while. Tell Patty his uncle sent you down there, and he'll give you a real deal on the chicken salad that inevitably follows. I couldn't apologize enough to George for missing the launch of this book. I've been a fan of George's work for a long, long time. I've quoted him on several occasions. And if I need to know something about Yeats, I avoid George because he'll always take me off my mistaken fantasies by citing the truth of the matter. But as long as I don't have that citation, I can go along in my ignorance and sing dumb, as I'm prone to do. In characteristic generosity, he just handed me this copy, his only copy that he had with him, with hopes that I would go buy one retail at a bookstore in this zip code. So, but it also put together two thoughts, the Russian bathhouse, the wild swans at Poole, and I think, are you the one, Keith, who's always telling me that these wild swans are the same fellows we have, the mute swans of the Methodist and Bayview brought to Petoskey? And now have inundated the lake that I stay on as much as I can. So you can learn a lot of things hanging around with poets and writers and the rest of it. But in particular, it put me in mind of the Russian Joseph Brodsky, who the year that he was hired to come here, I think he was the second poet in residence at the Frost. I mean, he was basically hired to, not to teach people how to write poems, but just because he was to walk around and be a sort of fixture in the imaginative life of the students in the way that Frost was. The year he was invited to do that, I think it was 1972, I was recently enrolled in, and it bears noting, I was president of the class by default, of the what would become the 1973 class of mortuary science at Wayne State University, so that in the fullness of time, when after publishing a poem some years later, I could be known as a poet funeral director. And that's sort of a hyphenated life that I know the publicists have tried to make a lot of. It's like a cop who becomes an opera star, or a wrestler who becomes a governor, or a performance artist who becomes president. But the idea to me is that in this particular time, it's very important. I think you were saying this, Larry, that the precision of language, you know, in an age when the systematic top-down abuse of adjectives has become rampant, it's important that we are careful about this language. I say this because, though I want to talk a lot about Joseph Brodsky and William Butler Yeats, I am not a scholar as the fellows that I'm with today, and happy to be with, because I was at that reading, John, of Wendell Berry and Seamus Heaney, and I was watching them scalp tickets outside, and I came home saying to my wife, what a wonderful thing, people are paying for poetry. You know, And but back to the hyphenated life, that performance artist who became president of the United States, I think these are times when precision in language is very, very important. So days like today, books like the one George is after putting out, and books like the ones that are being peddled in the back there are extremely important. My wife Mary often says to me that a poet undertaker is a little bit like a proctologist with a sideline and root canal. People don't really want that stuff. But I can tell you, if you buy a book of poetry in Poetry Month and tell your, you know, adult children or your grandchildren that you attended a poetry reading today, they will fear you in ways they don't currently. I promise. Just try it. I was at a conference in Galway some years ago, and I had the good luck of launching a book that year at this particular conference, and the star of the show for the conference, which lasts a whole week, was Seamus Heaney, and he was reading poems when he came to a poem he called Auden-esque, and it was based on the notion that Auden had, when he got word of Yeats's death in 1939, was it January, George? I think it was January the 28th. He commenced writing in memory of W.B. Yeats, a poem that appeared in that book I think you were talking about that was published in 1940. Mm-hmm. So from death to elegy to the book publication of saying a year, which is lightning speed by my lights. And in that poem, you will recall, I think it's the last section where Auden, who I always imagined was on his way to Michigan at the time he wrote this. He wasn't, of course. George can tell me that if he gets the citation before dark. But for now, he was on his way to Michigan, where he had a job lined up the following year. And Earth receive an honored guest. William Yeats is laid to rest. Let the Irish vessel lie emptied of its poetry. He was, and Heaney was quick to point this out, he was trying to commune with the dead in this act of elegy. Art, actually poetry, is what we do, according to Auden, to break bread with the dead. And Heaney added, when he was introducing his elegy for Joseph Brodsky, that if art is what we do to break bread with the dead, then rhyme and meter are the table manners. And that actually, in writing Earth Receive an Honored Guest, William Yeats's, Auden was mimicking Yeats's late rhyme, Irish poets learn their trade, sing whatever is well made, scorn the sword now, growing up all out of shape from toe to top. Professor Bornstein will tell us, I think, that was written late in 1938. I'm thinking November. I'm thinking he knew he had days that were numbered. But in honoring the dead man, that early 1939, Auden's effort was to mimic not only his honor and affection for the man, but to mimic his table manners. Not only to break bread, but to break them in the same rhyme and meter that he'd been given by the Irish master. So that when Heaney wanted to honor Joseph Brodsky, who died, as it turned out, strangely, on January 28th, the same date as Yeats, almost 60 years later, was it 1996, I think it was. Was he 55? Too young. Was it New York? Was it like Yeats, dying in a foreign country? Who's to know, but Joseph, yes, you knew the beat. His Dunedin's metric feet dance to it unstressed and stressed, laying William Yeats to rest. Therefore, Joseph, on this day, as you can, how you can, no, well, I mix them up all of the time. Let me see if I have it written down. I think I probably do. Therefore, Joseph, on this day, Yates's anniversary, double-crossed and death-mark date, January 28. In its measured ways, I tread again, quatrain by constrained quatrain, meeting grief and reason out, as you said, a poem ought. So it goes on and on with all sorts of troche, falling thus, grief and meter order us. Repetition is the rule, spins on lines we learned at school. I thought, sitting there in the theater in Galway, what a great thing to have this conversation ongoing amongst and between poets who down the decades and centuries and generations seem to pick up where the other ones left off. And one of the reasons I was so glad, that bottle of water there I have open is, thanks. Was that it would give me a chance in front of all these people to say thank you to all the poets who are committing poetry here all the time. And when in, I think it was 1979, when I first got in the mail a book, a little slim volume called The Cry of Oliver Hardy by Michael Heffernan, someone who used to teach me at university and was banished to the hinterlands of Kansas and then Arkansas. But poems I had seen through a blur of bourbon and conversation that we used to carry on at his house, because, you know, we shared an Irish affliction and we all wanted to be internationally unheard of poets. But I had seen these poems in manuscript, and to behold them in a book that would, it quickly came into my brain box, outlive him in a library, which is the literary equivalent of a mausoleum, full of echoes and voices that come back to us in the way Frost come back to us, and John Kennedy's come back to us, and Theodore Repin's come. All these poets who've been committing poetry in hopes that somebody will remember a line or the book will find its way to the shelf. And I remember holding that book in my hand and thinking, boy, I would really like one of those for myself, because I'd like my kids to someday know what it was that was preoccupying me when I was supposed to be listening to their life and times, but I was invariably looking at their earlobes and counting syllables or trying to figure out a metaphor or something like that. I wanted them to know that I wasn't just wasting the time. I was stealing it from my attention to them. But they would say, well, at least he put it to good use. It's in a book, on a shelf. It outlived him. There's a narcotic feeling about holding the book of a living writer, which is why you'll have the opportunity soon after I put a gob in it to go back there and buy books of living writers who will soon regale you with their living voices in poems that they have made up out of nothing. Creative rotting, you know? It's really a made thing. And for poets and for people for whom the language precision is a serious matter, who really see as part of our resistance the importance of reading and writing and speaking in tongues. One act of resistance is to read poetry out loud to yourself in some place with good acoustics. I would recommend this Russian bathhouse, but on a night when they're not like showering. But something with tile and really fine acoustics. I've always admired, what I wanted to say was, it was 1984 that I saw a poem in Poetry Magazine by Alice Fulton. It was called Traveling Light. It was about her father, as I recall. And this was before the time that I would weep. It was before our surgeries that make us weep at anything with meaning. But at the time, it made me weep just for the words of it, just for the power of a half-orphaned daughter to write about her father in such electric language that it made me weep. So I looked up in the back of the Journal to see that this woman who had recently brought tears to my eyes with her poem was at the University of Michigan, where she was absconding to some fellowship that was no doubt given by someone like you, Nick, or somebody like you, John, or maybe you, Larry, I don't know, but she was being paid to be a poet here. So I wrote her a letter saying, your poem took my breath away. And she wrote back and said, let's have lunch. This has never happened again. And it probably never will, but I want you to know that I did have lunch with her, and after saying to her that I occasionally wrote poems, in fact, the only reason I saw her poem in Poetry Magazine is I got a free subscription for having published a poem there. It's mostly because John Nims was the editor, a man from Muskegon, who used to sort of put his finger on the thumb of Michigan poets, even people from Milford, Michigan. So I got into a magazine I probably had no business being in. Nor did I have any business being in the workshop that was meeting in those days between Alice Fulton, Richard Tillinghast, Keith Taylor, Stephen Dunning of blessed memory. There was a woman named Martha, a crackerjack poet. One of the indignities of ages, we cannot remember her last name. But for me to be able to come from Milford, Michigan, where I had missed a meeting, so I became vice president of the Chamber of Commerce in the same year that I was president of the Rotary Club, to come and sit among the poets, to have an invitation to table, to be part of that feast, that common table was truly a gift. In days since then, I have had dinner at Keith's house and Larry's house. I probably crashed a meal or two at yours, John. I know I've been to Nick's on many occasions. Richard Tillinghast, I hope he comes back and just hauls up with Mary long enough to have another one of those dinners at which you meet Don Hall some night, or Seamus Heaney some night, who once nudged me when I was off. He was here reading and I wasn't here, although I'd heard him a couple or three times here by then, including the night that you talked about. And he said to me, I love what you did with Nora's house, meaning my little hovel on the west coast of Ireland. And I thought to myself, what business had he being there? And then it occurred to me that at a dinner some months before in London, I was sitting with his editor, Chris Reed, and his wife, may she rest in peace, Lucinda. Chris was allowing us how, and this was the years when Hughes and Heaney were the photographs on the big windows in Queen Square of Faber and Faber. And he was saying, you know, I've never been to Ireland. And I'm thinking, you're the editor for the greatest poet since Yeats. And you have to go to my place. And he took me up on it because the rent was right. And he went over there, and I think Seamus, thinking that they might slaughter him, the locals, slaughter Christopher, because Christopher is English in a way that it's hard to be. So Seamus and Mari, who were out jaunting around in his Mercedes-Benz, called into the house in Moline, and they brought a bottle of apparently very expensive wine, and the Reeds had been down to the fishmongers in Carrickholt and disabuse them of a lobster the size of a small child, a couple of them. And they had planned this meal, and they got to this point in the meal where the butter had been drawn, the wine was uncorked and breathing, all the steaming of lobsters had been done or boiled, whatever they do to them. But there was no pliers, to remove. And I said, well, how did that work out? And he said, well, you had a hammer in that little press in the front hallway. And the image of the, by that time, Nobel laureate on the flagstones of my hovel, banging at the lobster to remove the meat from him on all fours, I thought, this image will scar me for life. But I've never forgotten it. And every time I have lobster, as I did a month or so ago or a couple weeks ago, in the Virgin Islands, I thought, famous Seamus on the floor of my house banging at the lobster, And he wrote me this fax afterwards. I didn't want to take up all his time because people wanted to talk to me. He wrote me this fax and he said, it put me in mind of Durr's rhino. Great debris and great delight. The man was, as we all know, always in full metaphor mode, so I had that framed and put it in my office so that I would remember this part about great debris and great delight. And then I thought, I don't want to wait till he dies to practice this troche falling, thus grief and Peter order us. And so I'll finish with a couple of verses of my unpublished and failing poem called Heaney-esque. Seamus, yes, you told it true. Williams, Meter, Whiston's too. Borrowed it to say goodbye when your Russian Joseph died. Therefore, Seamus, on this day, as your people celebrate how you came to life and time, April 13th, 39, I come counting syllables line by line, the children's drill by which old lines and alphabets, prayers we quit but can't forget, echo still, icing a cake bright with candles for your sake. I come with this, don't worry, to praise you, not to bury. Once when Chris and Mrs. Reed were on Howells in West Moline, you and Mari happened by. They had lobster, you brought wine, but no pliers in the place could remove the creature's case. Mighty movers, each a match for Durr's rhino, at last found a hammer in the drawer, cracked them on that flaggy floor. A feast we fought for, you write, great debris and great delight. Great debris, delight indeed, so it is with this life. We hammer at the moment till all that's left is memorable, like the bodies found in bogs, like the erstwhile minute gone. All that's left is breaking bread, so you say, so Auden said. Bite the cake then, not the dust. Blow the candles out, the rest is easy. Keeping going, mostly getting up mornings, checking pulses, brushing teeth. Eat more fruit, Adam, heard Eve. She was right, for every core wants a feast worth fighting for. So to hear and hearten you, on your birthday I salute. If the end of art is peace, live forever, never cease. It took me the best part of a week, I think, to clack that baby together, and I sent it off to the Irish Times, who refused it on principle. And then I sent it to the Times of London, where I had a name to drop, and they printed it on the great man's birthday in their front page of their second section, where they usually had a briefly clad millennial. But anyway, I was amazed when I woke up early one morning. I was up north and on the fax machine, there was this clatter out of the fax machine as the paper kind of was jamming itself out, and I went downstairs, got a cup of coffee, and picked up the fax, and it was in the poet's unmistakable code from a long distance number, and it read, "What an undertaking, Tom." Tumpty, 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 tumpty. Beating with a meter stick, keeping time by talk and tick. Talk that isn't cheap, I know. Gowden's wherefore Gowden. Talk that isn't cheap, I talk that's light but carries weight, ballasted but still on fate. Talk from one who's learned the trade, nailing down all things well made, lines and lids and varnished boards, brass plates, the bone house, box of words. This reply, dear Tom, is brief. Straws were what he needs, a sheaf. Heartened, honored, more alive, thanks to you at 65. keeping going still the thing, as you well know, whose trochees ring the changes true. Heaney-esque makes it worthwhile at the desk. Well, I wouldn't have had any hope of having a multi-decade correspondence and an ongoing conversation with poets like Heaney and O'Driscoll and many who are happily still alive, and many of the people in this room, had it not been for Alice and Keith and Richard and Stephen and Linda and Nick and Larry and John and a dozen other nameless wonders who let someone living on the margins in for the feast you've been carrying on here for years. And I'm very grateful.